0141 951 1025. It's time to talk football. It's Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Good evening and welcome to Clyde One Super Scoreboard as we enter League Cup quarter-final week. Rabbi Matondo is Rangers' latest injury worry, out for 6 weeks ahead of the visit of Livingston tomorrow. First up tonight, Kilmarnock taking on Hearts, but there is international action as well. The Scotland women take on Belgium, and Duncan Ferguson is the new manager of Inverness Cali Thistle. I'm Gordon Duncan, and joining me tonight you have Jim Duffy and Gordon DL. I like this mad part of the season, Gordon, where we go from Europe to the league, to the League Cup, and back again, all within the space of a few days.
Yeah, it's a hectic schedule, especially for those teams that are still in the Cup, and it starts tonight. Kilmarnock and Hearts down at Robbie Park. I think it'll be a very good game. Then you look at tomorrow night's fixtures, a lot of terrific games in there. I think all eyes will be in Easter Road. I think that's a cracker. And we've got the news today that Big Dunk's back in Scotland, up at Inverness, so it'll be interesting to see how he does.
Yeah, Jim Duffy, you can't ever really separate competitions in this country, because it feels like, although everyone wants to win silverware and that stands alone, there are a couple of teams involved this week who could really be doing with a straightforward game after what happened in the league at the weekend.
Yeah, I mean, again, it's just the highs and lows, the way it's, it swings very, very quickly because the games come up. If you look at a couple of weeks ago, Rangers lost to Celtic, came in for an awful lot of criticism. And then they have a fantastic result in Europe against Real Betis, and a terrific performance as well, I have to say that. And then they have a mediocre performance, but a good result at the weekend. You know, so with Celtic being out of the Cup, I think it's a very, very open competition this year. And so I think you know, the Cup matches come up over the next 24 hours or so are absolutely huge for how a lot of clubs will be determined how their season might unfold.
And I mean, only usually say three headlines, there are loads tonight. Celtic fans, I wonder what you make of Anthony Ralston signing a new long-term contract at the club as well. So whether it's tonight's League Cup action, tomorrow's League Cup action, thoughts hanging over from the weekend, new contracts, international game at Hampden tonight, whatever it is, it's the same number, 0141 951 1025, or Twitter, or X, or whatever we're calling it these days. I'm a creature of habit, at Clyde SSB. So do get all your thoughts in. At last night's look back on Ibrox was lively, I think we'll call it that. I played you a couple of the clips from last night's show in the office before we came on. So Rangers fans, if you've not quite got it off your chest yet, which might seem weird because it was a victory, we're here for you. We had all sorts last night.
Yeah, I heard some of it, and obviously you played me a few clips before we come on air, Gordon. I don't really blame the Rangers fans. You can put up the argument that it's all about winning football games. They've got a great opportunity tomorrow night. They're at home. You know, they'd fancy them against Livingston. But I think where the problem is just now is I think a lot of fans are complaining about the style of play. I watched their game against St Johnston, and I wasn't impressed with it, but I was all about getting the 3 points. I watched their game against Motherwell, and I've got to say, I thought Motherwell were very unlucky not to come away with something. But once again, Rangers got the 3 points. So for results-driven business, it's very hard to argue with. For entertainment style of play, I think it's got to get better.
Yeah, look, Jim, we've always said there's a sort of unique pressure, if you like, that comes with Glasgow. That's why shows like this exist, probably. If you'd tuned in last night, for sure you would have thought Rangers had lost, undeniably. But then, as Gordon says, that is just the way of it here. Michael Beale can't escape that. It was Neil Banfield on press duty today. They could be doing with something big and impressive soon, you suspect.
Yeah, I think he has to tweak the style. I think it's been difficult because he's had injuries. Of course, the key players, and there was another injury at the weekend, Rabbi Matondo, get injured and looks as if he's going to be out for a number of weeks now. So I think that's definitely, you know, got some mitigating circumstances for Michael Beale. But I think if you look at, you know, the Morton game in the Cup, as Daz said, you know, St Johnson game, you know, the weekend game against Motherwell, you know, they've had positive results in all of those, but quite mediocre performances. And I think they have to find a way that when teams, you know, are organised against them and look to play them on the counter, that they move the ball quicker, they're a bit sharper, there's a bit more intensity. You're not always going to get that from the crowd has happened against Real Betis. And also, Real Betis came and, you know, were positive against Rangers, so that made the game a bit more open, a bit more space. It's when teams negate that space, when they keep it compact, when they keep it tight, that Rangers seem to be a bit pedestrian. And that's the style that I think that they have to improve upon. They have to move the ball a lot quicker, they have to start the games with more intensity, and then when they get themselves in front, as they did at the weekend, they then have to put the game to bed, and they haven't done that enough.
Yeah, Rangers fans, if you've got the updated version of your thoughts from the weekend, I don't know if those of you who were particularly annoyed have calmed down or if it's getting worse or whatever, let us know on the phones. We'll hear from Neil Banfield, who was on press duty today. What do you make of that Rabbi Matondo injury as well? Again, I feel like maybe a few weeks ago, a couple of months ago, that wouldn't have really registered, but he has all of a sudden come and become a sort of main man in this attacking setup. So what do you think there? How big a blow is that? It is yet another injury. Celtic fans, new contract for Anthony Ralston, what do you make of that? Still looking back on the weekend, if you so wish. You don't need me to remind you there will be no League Cup action this midweek either. So whatever, it's out there, pick up the phone. Maybe we'll even get some Inverness Cali Thistle fans. We don't get it too often, but that's an interesting, we'll leave it at that, an interesting managerial appointment. How do you sum it up? Get in touch and let us know. Ewan is a Celtic fan, he's from Hamilton, and he's going to kick us off tonight. Take it away, Ewan.
Evening panel, how are we doing?
Good, you?
Good, Ewan.
Yeah, not bad, thank you. Just a wee point I wanted to make. I was listening to your show there, and I'm driving down. I was actually listening on the podcast, catching up to last night, and it was your man from Florida that was on, just basically saying how impressed he was with sort of the dynamic between Callum McGregor and Brendan Rodgers, and the trust and everything they had with each other. That Brendan comes up with a plan, and then Callum is his man on the park, executes it, and we go ahead and we got a very difficult win, and made it up make me look easy in the end, which, to be honest, gave me a lot of hope and a lot of joy, because I feel like we've just been looking for a wee spark, and I think that we're going to take a lot for that performance and that result, because it's not historically been a very good hunting ground for us, but kicking on for there, I think that it's onwards and upwards now, and it clears any kind of cobwebs or any leftover for a sort of annual hangover, which I think has been hanging about the club. So I think everybody's going to buy into Brendan Rodgers, all the players, I mean, buy into Brendan Rodgers' way of doing things now and just kick on for there.
Yeah, well, listen, if that is the case, and to pour cold water on, it's probably only time will tell sort of thing, because we don't know what challenges Celtic will face. But who would have thought then, if that is the case, that an away game at Livy is the spark you were looking for?
Yeah, I found it very strange for Johnston to come out and say that you know, it could be a big result leading into winning the championship. There's still a lot of games to go. Everybody talks about this Livingston away fixture, very difficult, i.e. because of the pitch. I never thought for 1 minute watching the game, even when Celtic went down to 10 men, that for me they were in total control of the game. I thought they started the game well. If Celtic go and start the game well and get into their passing rhythm, get their, you know, influential players on the ball, then Celtic will beat you because they've got better players. And even at 10 men, when they decided to stick with the two up front, Maida and Kyogo, just the way they worked it as well, Gordon, I thought that Livingston were lucky to lose 3-0. I thought Celtic dominated most of the match. I was very disappointed in Livingston. I don't know what Jim's thoughts are on it. When you go a man advantage, especially at home against Celtic, you've got to try and use that. For me, they didn't capitalise that at all. They played right into Celtic's hands, and there was only got to be one winner, and Celtic ran out comfortable.
Ewan's taken a lot from it. He thinks, you know, believes it could be the one that gets rid of the Ange ball comparisons and so on. Is it a bit early for that?
I think it's a bit early. Listen, Celtic won the game comfortably and deservedly so. Scored a couple of terrific goals, and they still had that wee bit extra quality. You could see the gulf in class was there. But Gordon was saying there, that Livingston didn't really put up, you know, the fight you thought they would. Yeah, people going about the pitch and all that, but they should be used to the pitches now. They've played them often enough, whether it's at Livingston, whether it's at Kilmarnock or whatever. I don't think that the players are that fazed by that now. I think it was more the fact that Livingston really were quite flat and Celtic were in cruise control. And their quality players shown on the day, whether it be O'Reilly, Maida, Kyogo, there was players there that have just got that, they're better, as simple as that, and they won the game convincingly. Celtic were almost the master of their own downfall again, similar to the Feyenoord game where they made individual errors. And that will be the only concern, I think, at this moment in time for Brendan Rodgers. I think there is a spirit there. There is an understanding of how he wants to play the game. But they've made some basic individual errors in these games. They got away with them against Livingston on a couple of occasions. They didn't get away with them against Feyenoord. So it just depends on what level you're looking to take Celtic at this moment in time, or what level you're happy with. Are you happy domestically? I think yes. Have you still got to improve, you know, to take them to the next level, Europe? Absolutely. But obviously you need your top players to all be available, and Celtic are still a little bit like Rangers just now, you know, significant injuries, particularly in the central defence.
Who are the ones that you think can sort of thrive under Brendan Rodgers, Ewan? What are the early signs? Who are the players you think are going to be, you know, big influences this season?
He's a big one already. I think he's going to go straight to straight. Still a young guy. I didn't realise he's 22, I think he is now. Yep. 21 when I arrived. So I think he's going to go straight for straight. I think we'll actually struggle to keep a hold of him, to be honest. I think he'll attract a bit of interest to down south. I think players like that, and I think he'll just improve every day, like, across the board. He's a completely different way of doing it, a different animal for Ange. And I just feel like the guys have kind of enjoyed playing under Ange, and the football's been great, and we've got all the plaudits. And I just think when Brendan's come in, it's just taken a wee while just for the guys to just accept there's a different philosophy there. It's still a winning philosophy, but it's just different. And I feel like there's just been a bit of a hangover, but I feel like that result there is just going to be used to just kick on. And I think Brendan Rodgers is proven as a coach that he'll improve kind of young players come in. The wee guy home, I've got high hopes for him. I know it's really, really early days or whatever, but I know he's been sent off as well, and he's kind of debuted in Europe for us, but I just feel like he's somebody that Brendan can get his teeth into and just develop and bring on and mold the way he wants to.
I'm not getting, you know, there's the temptation to be dramatic with this comparison, but genuinely, I wonder how many games combined running you would have done in your career to add up to what Dalziel Maida does in one game. Could we be talking like five games?
Years? Five seasons. I think you could go a long, long way. He's an incredible player to have in your team, especially when you get down to 10 men. And as I say, him and Kyogo occupied Livingston's back four. No problem at all. The work rate was incredible. And all credit to the lad, because I think if anyone on the park deserved a goal, and it was a terrific goal, it was certainly him at the end. Going back to Ewan's point there, I think Matt Riley is starting to improve immensely under Brendan Rodgers. And the reason why, most importantly for a midfield player with the ability he's got, he's adding goals now. He's starting to score goals, and he's become a threat. Now, you look at, everybody talks about the disappointing day at Celtic Park against St Johnstone. If you look at that game again, O'Reilly probably on form with a score 2 or 3. You know, he's getting into these positions, he's getting more licence to go forward, he's a very intelligent footballer, and he's starting to show he knows where the back end is, and I think he's improved immensely under Roger.
You, in terms of today's news coming out of Celtic, probably just that Anthony Ralston new 4-year deal, what do you make of that? Is he one that you think can play a key role going forward?
I think he's been a bit unfortunate. He's had kind of runs in the team, and then he's kind of had a wee dip, and he's been out. I think he's been a bit unlucky timing wise as well, but every time he asks him to do a job for us, he does it. I mean, I've got no complaints for the guy. The guy works his socks off, and I do think he adds, but I just think he needs to go to a next level, and I'm fairly confident he'll be able to do that within that time span of that new contract that he's just been given. So I think he's only going to improve as well. So I'm quite happy.
I know Brendan Rodgers has made comments about, you know, wanting a Scottish influence as well. I think Stephen Welsh got a long-term deal recently as well. Whether that's part of it, I'm not saying he's only doing it for nationality, but maybe it does play a part. Because Anthony Ralston really seems to almost divide opinion a bit on this show, Jim, where some people feel like, you know, very reliable, Ewan said, not going to let you down, great to have around, and others are maybe not sure it's what Celtic want for that kind of next level. But I guess if Alistair Johnson's the number one anyway, is it good to have?
Yeah, I mean, listen, the top clubs, no matter Celtic or anyone else, want two players for every position, minimum. minimum these days. That's just the way the game is because of the amount of games they play, the intensity, the demands. And Antti Ralston is a really good fit for Celtic. You know, I mean, obviously, listen, he's had to play second fiddle. He's been out on loan, as we know, to the clubs. He said Michael Lustig, he said Juranovic, he said Johnston. You know, he said top players in front of him. So, you know, he's learning all the time. And, you know, he seems to be more confident when he goes in now. I think he's what, 23 or whatever it happens to be. So he's not a kid anymore. He's got enough games under his belt. He's played in some big games now, scored some important goals. I think it's a good sign. For what do you want to do? Go and spend another couple of million on a backup player when you've got a boy there who knows the club inside out. He's came through it. He's come through the tough times. He's had to fight his way to be a first team squad member. So I think all of those things mean you're a strong character. And I think that's something that Brendan Rodgers is really, happy with, as well as his ability on the pitch.
Yeah, I agree with that. I think it's a decent bit of business, Gordon. All credit to a lad. I think before Postecoglou came in, you would say that he didn't have a future.
He was at the door, wasn't he?
Yeah,
absolutely.
Definitely. And he'd been at Dundee United, St Johnstone, am I correct in that? And had loan spells there. Didn't really set the head on fire, but he came back in, he was given the opportunity, and that's what I like. If you're given the opportunity, especially when you look like your days are numbered, it's up to you to grab that opportunity. And you've got to say, the boy certainly did that. There's no doubt about that. He's never let Celtic down. Will he be the number one right back? Absolutely no. I think Alistair Johnston's got that sewn up. But if there's any problems or injuries or whatever, you would have no fear whatsoever of putting Ralston in there.
Thank you to you. And it's 01419511025 or Twitter at Clyde SSB. Building up to the game tonight, any of you Killy Hearts fans want to get involved, you can do. There's a big Scotland women's national team game at Hampden, of course, as well. What about you Rangers fans then? It was extremely lively on the show last night, looking back on Sunday. How do you feel now, a day on? Get your thoughts in. And what about Rabbi Matondo's injury? Keep your calls coming right now and we'll speak to you next. Jim Duffy and Gordon DL are here at 01419511025. So please give us a call and let us know what you're thinking tonight. It could be League Cup action. It could be reflecting on the Premiership weekend. It could be reacting to today's news headlines, whatever they may be. We'll take the lot right here. That's exactly what David in Clydebank has done. How's it going, David?
No problem, yourself, pal.
I can't complain at all. You're a Rangers fan, though, David, and it was a very interesting response on last night's show.
Very poor performance at the weekend. Very, very poor.
Overall, then, is the criticism, you know, booing at the end, if you like, of a win, is that fair? Do you get that? You agree with that, or is some of it over the top?
Well, I think Deal's days are numbered, pal. Actually, if it wasn't for Butland, they wouldn't be in a job right now. Honestly, like, what I can't understand is, like, well, he was under Gerrard, right? He was the one that's picking the team now. He's the man that's picking the team himself. And that, to me, we're going back to the Gerrard days, we're going back to front, titty-tatter football, you know what I mean?
There will be, if Rangers don't succeed this season, by whatever measurement, there can be loads of reasons for that. You do wonder, and because it's the type of thing you'll never really be able to prove, and you guys will know this, though. The difference between being the coach and being the manager, you wonder how much that will impact things, you know, for Michael Beale.
Well, that's a completely different role. There's no doubt about it. You know, you're in the background, you know, you're working with the tactics and the coaching side of it. But when you're a manager, you've got the responsibilities. You're the key decision maker, you know, whether you know, the team you pick, the recruitment, the style of play, the substitutions you make or don't make. And fans, you know, have got the opinion on the manager. They don't have the opinion on the coach, or very rarely anyway. So, you know, from David's point of view, he's saying there that up to Jack Butland. Listen, he had a couple of fantastic saves, three or four fantastic saves against Real Betis. And again, you need your goalkeeper to do well in these type of games. But it was still a fantastic result. And I felt second half performance in particular, Rangers deserved it. So that was a good performance. At the weekend, he had another couple of really good saves, but it's against Motherwell at home, and Rangers fans expect their team to be more on the front foot, play at a higher tempo, quicker, sharper. But you know, there are mitigating circumstances. I say they're only injuries, but I think when you're a club like Rangers, you can't use that as an excuse, because you still have huge resources and a huge squad in comparison to Motherwell. And I think at Motherwell at home, I think the Rangers fans are entitled. And fair play to Michael Beale. He didn't shy away from that. Mm-hmm. He said pretty much what most of the fans have said on this programme over the last couple of nights.
And David thinks Michael Beale's days are numbered, Gordon, which if they were to keep winning games, I mean, surely they wouldn't be. But I also get what David means. There's a feeling out there. I don't know how long or how easily you can put that back in the bottle.
Yeah, it's an interesting one because as a manager, and Jim will tell you, first and foremost, you've got to win football games. And Michael Beale's winning football games just now. He's got a great opportunity in this cup with Celtic not being in it. His next one tomorrow night's at home to Livingston, so you'd expect to go through in that. But I think the problem with most of the fans is they're turned off with the football. They're not enjoying it. Football is it's an expensive hobby now to go along and pay a lot of money, and you know how times are hard. And I'm not saying that you can go there week in, week out and be entertained with 3 and 4 and 5. But I've watched Rangers this season. Have I enjoyed watching their style of play? Absolutely not. I thought against St Johnston, it was the worst 90 plus minutes of my life to sit and watch it. I thought against Motherwell, I'll give Motherwell credit because I thought Motherwell should have went back down the M8 with something. But
you'd maybe go on to the 74.
But you can go the M8 as well and just cut off.
Nah,
onto the 74.
That's a crazy decision.
Then up Ebbles Road, turn right to the second round a bit. But I just think that it's very strange that a manager's winning games and
keeping clean sheets.
Yeah, and but people
then,
are
then,
still.
But then it's not strange, though, is it? Because you two know this environment. Like, it's not strange. It's not remotely strange.
I mentioned it
before in the final days of Giovanni van Bronckhorst. They beat Dundee 1-0 in the cup. There was booze at the end.
Everyone said that night,
oh, look, but it's the cup. And they got through. And a couple of weeks later, he wasn't the manager.
Generally, it's over a longer period of time. I think that's the thing. When you have, let's just say, half a season and you've managed to win a few games or the majority of games, but you haven't been at full tilt, you haven't entertained, for want of a better phrase, then I think, fair enough, you then think, okay, well, you've won enough games now, so the players should have enough confidence, enough belief to then, you know, let them off the leash a little bit and go and express themselves, play with a bit more freedom. This is still quite early on in the season, so the most important thing in the early part of the season is make sure you win as many games as possible to give yourself a platform later on. Even the big teams, I mean, I've listened to key managers over the years, whether it would be the top managers, you talk about the Klopp, successful Guardiola, even a lot of them would say the early part of the season is about building, getting yourself ready for when, you know, the climax of the season, so you peak at the right times. So can Rangers improve gradually over the next couple of months? That's what really what they've got to do. So is it by the turn of the year they're neck and neck with Celtic at the very least?
But clearly, David, for fans like you, the fear is that these wins are suggesting that a defeat or a draw is round the corner. Is that what you're fearful of?
Yeah, basically, because I think Motherwell should have had at least a one each draw. I agree with you, the pundits, right? And also, I can't understand why he brings a centre-half on for, I mean, we're like 1-0 up, chasing the game, Motherwell all over us for the last 20 minutes, plus tries for the second one, and he brings a centre-half on. I can't understand that at all.
Yeah, that was one that Michael Beale did get a lot of scrutiny for, Gordon.
We also went to
a back three, which he's made no secret of kind of wanting to do that. Obviously saw an opportunity. Was that a strange one for you? Or?
Yeah, a little bit, but I can understand it because he's bringing on John Souter, and I think everybody's, you know, there's a debate there whether Souter should be starting week in, week out instead of Davis. So it gave him the opportunity then let his two wing-backs go really high up the park with the freedom he going and try to get deliveries. I think he just tried to change something, Gordon. And I don't mind that at all, because if you're not playing particularly well, and you've got to say Motherwell had great spells in the game, then you change it, especially when you get an injury and you decide, you know what, I'm not going to stick with the same system. I'm going to change the system. I'm going to try and get my wing-backs higher up the pitch. I'm going to try and maybe overload the middle of the park with Souter, Stepman, whatever it may be. But it's not happening for him. But I think Jim makes a great point there, and that's the reason why I'm a bit surprised. it's early season. It's what, five league games or whatever it may be. Now, if he gets to Christmas and we're still getting these phone calls, Michael Beale will really struggle to hold his job this season unless he really has a remarkable season winning trophies.
What do you make of the news then, David? Because it was brought about by Rabbi Matondo looking at 6 weeks out.
Well, right, we might miss him, right, but see, it's just Quintus as well. Like, why should Quintus in the Rangers team? The boy brings nothing to the team. Absolutely nothing. The boy was missing in action the whole game on Sunday.
Yeah, I think it's difficult. You know, any player that comes in, if he's a couple of wonder games at the start, people are, you know, you wax lyrical and say, oh, he's going to be the next superstar. If he doesn't settle in straight away, I just feel that, you know, fans, you know, put themselves in that position. You know, you're a young lad, you come to a massive club, you know, the team's not playing great at this moment in time. You've got to settle into a different country, you've got to get to know a different style, a different culture. Everything's different. And we don't seem to accept that footballers don't always hit the ground running. They need a bit of time to settle in.
Let's hear from the Rangers camp today. It was Neil Banfield who was on press duty today. He says the management are aware of fan anger, but thinks performances will improve, thinks they've already put in good performances, and did confirm that that knee problem for Rabbi Matondo will see a 6 week absence.
Yeah, of course. We all are. We can't get away from that. We speak as a group. And you analyse and you're prepared for what's coming. And I think we've prepared for this and we deal with it. And no, it's understandable, you can see it, but I think when you come into these games, these period of games, it's I think it's tough with the players. It's mentally, we had a big result on Thursday. And it's how you get over that and then you approach the next game. And I think the games have gone well in the results, but obviously we've seen that we got a little bit anxious on Sunday, not getting the second goal. And that does create a little bit of anxiety amongst the team, and we defended well. We won the game, and now we push on to the next to the cup game on Wednesday night. When you look at our three clean sheets, the way the team defends and the structure of the team, and the way we are playing at times, I think it's coming. It's definitely coming, and I think it only bodes well for the future.
You know, when results don't go well, everything just gets brought into the spotlight, doesn't it? I had a fascinating afternoon on social media because Neil Banfield's existence at the press conference even annoyed some people, Rangers fans. Now, it probably was planned. These things usually are. It might be Michael Beale must do goodness knows how many interviews in a week, and it might be, well, you take the League Cup games. But still, some are saying, well, that's fine. But after the reaction at the weekend and the way we're feeling about things, the manager should have been the one fronting up today. We don't want to hear from. So, I mean, even that sort of stuff's getting. Does it matter to you?
No, it doesn't matter to me. I can understand it. Maybe they looked at it the other way and thought, look, go and get a different voice out there, a different opinion. Go and let the fans hear somebody else rather than me saying the same things over and over again just to mix it up. But you're right. They'll probably have planned that, who's going to do the press conferences. So why change it? Because they won on Thursday night. They had a terrific result on Thursday night. Yes, they didn't play particularly well Sunday. They won. They're getting into a big, important game tomorrow. I don't think we should read too much into that. Wouldn't really bother me, that.
No, I think that, it was probably planned. You're right, Gordon, I don't think there's any doubt about that. And therefore, what are you going to do? Just change it because, you know, you had a disappointing performance at the weekend? I don't think so. And listen, you know,
is it maybe about to play devil's advocate? Is it maybe, though, about taking the temperature of, you know, the fan reaction? Because it's not like you don't know that there's this groundswell of negativity out there.
Well, he mentioned that straight away. He said that we understand, you know, the fans' views there. But I think from Michael Beale's point of view, if he expressed his disappointment and his frustration after the game, I think, you know, pretty much, I thought he was very, very honest in his assessment of the game. So maybe if he thinks, if he goes into and does another negative media conference, that's not an ideal thing for a manager to do. So give a different voice, give his assistant the opportunity to speak to the media. And then when he goes into the speak to the players, he can speak with a little bit more positivity rather than walk into a dressing room after having condemned the players again, really, after a performance at the weekend. So, yeah, I think that is actually pretty decent management at this stage, of leading up to the... Which is a very, very important match for Rangers, there's no doubt about it. You know, they really have to win this match with the opportunity to get the first piece of silver.
Let's bring in George on the line. Thank you to David. George, what's your take on it?
Hi, guys. I'm just pure disappointed with the the team performance? Why is Michael Beale not doing the press conferences? It's a shambles right now. If we play like we did against Motherwell, I can see us getting smashed tomorrow.
Yeah, I mean, look, the guys have just great timing on the call. The guys have been, you know, speaking about it. So do you care, George? Do you? I mean, Neil Banfield probably planned to do this press conference for the League Cup anyway. Does it matter? What are you saying, that Michael Beale should be fronting up today or what?
He's the man. He should be there speaking to the press, speaking to the fans. It looks as though he's just hiding now. I quite like Michael Beale, but lately it's just been like watching paint dry.
Yeah, I've said it even tonight on the show. I've not been impressed with it. I've said for the last few weeks anyway, when Michael Beale's come in for to be put under pressure, especially from Rangers supporters, not us, that I don't believe that the right way is to go and sack Michael Beale just now, so early in the season. He's still got a very important game tomorrow night. It just shows you the difference now. They had a terrific result Thursday. They still won on Sunday. They're three clean sheets, as the assistant manager was talking about. They've got an opportunity to be in a semi-final here. And you're saying that Livingston, a supporter, George, coming on and saying, I can see us getting smashed tomorrow night with Livingston. You know, I don't know where the Rangers supporters are at this moment in time. No, I'm not blaming them, because I would not like to be going along to Ibrox and paying my well hard earned cash if I ever do that.
You've never worked hard for your money in your life.
So I can understand that, but I think there's a little bit of scope there.
Thank you very much to George. Let me tell you about this before we go any further. Clyde One. Now, you see, usually I should be organised enough to find my fancy Make Me A Winner information to tell you about, but for some reason, I don't think I've got it. There it is. There we go. See, if you just pad and you're just talking off, you'll find it in the end. We've had six winners in a row, by the way. So remember the little kind of quiet spell. Six in a row now. Today it was John, who bagged 84 grand. What a prize that is.
He was planning for a wedding, was he not?
Yeah, he's been with his partner Lisa for years, planning for a wedding, and now they can. Heck of a wedding that.
Yeah, the bowling club's out.
Give me a few bowling clubs for 84 grand. I'll get that spent.
Let's keep this streak up. We'll have hopefully another winner tomorrow. £86,000 richer. It could be you. So the call's going to be made after 3 p.m. straight into your bank account as well, the money goes. But you need to be in the draw, obviously. Text yes to 61025. Texts are £2 plus your standard network rate. You can enter at clyde1.com, and online entries are £2, or call 0330 880 4523. Calls charged at a standard rate as well. It's over 18s only. All the rules for this network competition are online. So if you get the call from us after 3 p.m. tomorrow, Wednesday the 27th, answer within five rings, say Make Me A Winner straight away to win £86,000. So text yes to 61025. Clyde One Super Scoreboard. Joel is on the line to join Gordon DL and Jim Duffy. Take it away, Joel.
Hello. I just want to say that I think all the pressure on Michael Beale is wrong. Totally wrong. Only one simple reason being, all the Rangers fans wanted him. They cheered when he signed for Rangers. So all of a sudden, we're still getting the points. So, pretty speaking, give him time. Give him to the end of the season.
Yeah, look, I think there is balance out there. You know, you're always going to hear sort of negative voices louder. Graham's on Twitter saying, might get some stick, but I'm a season ticket holder, 18 years of winning 1-0 every week wins you a treble. Who cares? We've just beaten a very decent La Liga side. It might not be pretty, but it's 3 points and a victory at the end of the day, which is undeniably true. But to go back to what the last caller says, it's not about that as such. It's about seeing these 1-0 wins and fearing that they're not going to continue forever based on the performance level. That's what people are fearful of, is it not?
Yeah, but you've got to cross that bridge when you come to it, Gordon.
That's the point, though. People would say, don't cross the bridge once you're 7 points behind Celtic.
It might never happen. If they're continuing, look at their defensive record just now, their clean sheets. On Thursday night, I thought it defended very well indeed against decent players, a top quality side. It gets back to the style of play, but this is my opinion, only my opinion. I totally agree with Joel. Every Rangers fan I heard when Michael Beale was getting appointed was delighted. They wanted Michael Beale in because it was well known that he was the brains behind Steven Gerrard, the spoke about what a fantastic coach he was, how he's got to improve players that are at Ibrox, how he's got his signings will be good, and the style and the attacking football. And I think that's where they've been let down, because they get built up to go along to watch Rangers and the new players coming in with this new brand of football. That it's not immersed, let's be honest about it. It's boring football, but they're still getting results. But if you're back to manager with, what, nine mm-hmm. signings and a lot of money in the summer, you can't be calling for his head after, what, five, six league games. I just don't buy that. And especially after a good result on Thursday night, an opportunity to be in semi-final of the first competition. They're playing Livingston tomorrow night at home. You'd expect them to win that, whether they played well or not. So I think it's a wee bit early to go for Michael Beale, yeah. But some Rangers fans have had enough already.
Obviously, if it's through the lens of the signings, Gordon's right and Joel's right when we talk about time. But if the phrase is specifically, you know, give Michael Beale time, people quite rightly point out, well, he has been here since November. You know, it's not like he came at the start of the season.
Yeah, but just under a year, and you've had one transfer window really to work with. But in terms of the players he brought in previous to this window, so whether it was Davis, you know, like Cantwell, Raskin, guys like that, you know, John Souter, these have all they were all seemed to be successful signings. I think it was this summer's recruitment, Gordon, that hasn't changed. You know, and Rangers fans feel as if they haven't, you know, improved the side. Now, again, those type of players playing for Rangers, coming from the clubs they've came from, you know, I think there's still a big step up. You know, the demands, the expectations, as well as the style. And also, as I mentioned, you'd have to say to Michael Beale, what's your favourite system? How do you want to play? How did you see yourself playing this year? Probably 4-3-3. But he hasn't had very, very few of those players available to him. There are still some, you know, the jury's out. There's no doubt Dessers, I think, you know, Lammers, these type of guys, C-Mat, the jury's still out. There's no doubt about that in these key areas. But some of the other players have just been unfortunate with injuries. So the likes of Joel is coming up, standing by his manager, wanting to be given more time. I think you have to give him at least another couple of months. Michael Beale's record in terms of domestically is actually very, very good. You know, since he came in terms of results, clean sheets, win percentages, that most other managers would be delighted with that. Unfortunately, if you're the Rangers manager, you're getting judged by your opposition, which
big
is the
games,
Celtic
though,
manager.
In
the key games, you lose a game. I'm talking about over the piece. It's a good percentage.
Do you not think I think it's a lot to do with signings as well, because he brought so many in. He lost a lot of good players and experienced players that knew how to win at Rangers, but he brought a lot of players in. And if you sum it up right now, Jim, I would probably say Butland is the only one that's probably hit the ground.
Well, so as a counter to that last tweet, Ali says, winning ugly is fine if you can still control games. And that scenario, you might say you'll take 3 points like that every game. The problem is Rangers have no control of these games just now, as was evident particularly in the last 15 minutes at Ibrox. What about Stephen Partick? What have you got for us tonight, Stephen?
Hi, how you doing, Paro?
Good.
First time caller.
Good to have you. What made you call then?
Right, well, what I'm calling about is regarding the assistant we ran giving you the conference today as such. He done the last one in the lead up to the cup. McCoy's used to do it under Walter, and McAllister used to do it under Gerrard. I don't think this is a new thing. I don't think Beale's hiding. I think that's just part of it's a cup thing, giving him his place to maybe so the fans get to know the assistant managers as such as well. I don't really think there's a big issue in that. Maybe it's a good thing that Beale isn't here, but sometimes he just flaps his gums a wee bit too much. But other than that, I would like to think that Beale needs to start playing a settled team. Change constantly is just too much.
Yeah, oh, look, we did say that on the press conference thing. It's just, you know what football's like, perception's important, and I know it's an entirely different scenario, but that arrangement, whether it's on the pitch or in the press room, works until Walter Smith grabs Ali McCoist and gets out of his seat or whatever it is, that famous image, you know, coming to take control. So, you know, like, I guess some fans, rightly or wrongly, were hoping that the press conference equivalent of that
took place today.
Can you not get fed up listening to the manager as well, though? Because the press will obviously ask.
That's exactly why it's done, for sure. Yeah. But like we said, sometimes once the perception's out there, what do you do? If you've got a fan, and I don't know if it was one or 100, but the guy that called in saying, I'm a Rangers fan, it looks to me like he's hiding.
He's hiding, yeah. Well, I must admit, I don't think there's any way whatsoever that he's hiding away from responsibility. I don't think any Rangers manager could do that. I think that they know that as soon as you accept that role to be the manager of Glasgow Rangers, you're in the firing line 24/7, 365 days a year. You know that. Yeah. So you're not going to shy away from that. I just think, as Stephen has said there, that it's been pre-planned. Neil Banfield gets the opportunity to go and speak to the press in a slightly different manner than Michael Beale, and Michael Beale will be quite rightfully back in front of the cameras tomorrow night after the game, before and after the game.
I've got a bit of sympathy for Neil Banfield, because then he's put in there and then I know he's vastly experienced, but I think there was a sort of, I don't know whether you'd call it a slip of the tongue. He mentioned Rangers beating PSV, which they obviously didn't, right? But he said it. Like, listen, listeners to this show will know fine well that verbal diarrhea is possible. I wasn't aiming that at you. Don't look at me.
You're looking at me. And I totally agree with you.
You know, and kind of then using that as a, listen, look at this guy. He's saying we beat PSV when we didn't, sort of thing. So there was always going to be that extra level of scrutiny. Just on the team selection, though, Stephen, do you have any sympathy for Michael Beale when you talk about chopping and changing? Are injuries dictating that a bit at the moment?
Well, that was my point. I spoke to Chris as well. I think we should have started with a set team, and injuries and suspension start ringing in. We should start with our best 11 as we should be every week until, oh, I know we've got a lot of games and different formations and such, but if the team's winning, they're settled. In the European game during the week against Betis, the second half, they started looking like a unit. They started playing really good football. Some of it was really good. I was like, oh, but here we go. Rangers are back. They're starting to join as a unit. But then Motherwell, changes. Don't understand why they never started the roof up front. There's no field commitment says he can't play two games a week. But he's been injured. He needs game time. If they gave him half an hour or an hour, and brought him off, but it starts with Dessers, who the fans are not too happy with at the moment, because in my eyes he's never a number 9. He's maybe an 8, maybe a 10, but he's definitely not a number 9. But Roof is more in mode. I'm not going to say he's an Alfredo, but he's more in that mode. He likes to play the defenders and bully them, but you never get the time.
The thing is, though, Michael Beale just keeps asking Kamar Roof to go to the well, and he gets injured again, that'll come back on him. It's already sort of happened with Tom Lawrence. I'm not saying it's Michael Beale's fault, but you're almost damned if you do, damned if you don't there.
I could be wrong here, but I don't know if Michael Beale looks at his squad and knows right now what his strongest.
Sure, but there will be injuries now.
Yeah, and I was going to say to Stephen, I do feel a little bit for him as a manager, because he can't get that consistency because of i.e. injuries. You look at Danilo up at St Johnston, you're thinking, is that goal going to kickstart his season? The poor lad gets injured and he's out for whatever time he's out for. And then all of a sudden, I think what frustrates the Rangers fans as well, the transfer market and all the players coming in, the players going out, players that were you're thinking of leaving, all of a sudden Scott Wright pops his head up at the weekend, the starting 11, you're thinking, where are we going with this?
We'll leave it there. One thing you'll learn on this show, you can never make a sweeping statement about any fan base, because Big Mo is on. Tell that caller, not all Rangers fans wanted Beale. And he's attached a tweet of his from November last year saying Beale will be a disaster. So there you go. Anyway, it's that time of the night already.
Beat the Pundit with the Scottish Sun. For the best football news and opinion online, thescottishsun.co.uk/football.
Right, so let's play Beat the Pundit. The Pundits are on a long winning streak. I don't know how that happened. 01419511025, and the lines close at 7.
Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Jim Duffy and Gordon DL are here. It's 01419511025. We've had lots about Rangers after the performance at the weekend, albeit it was a win, as many people are also pointing out. Celtic fans, we've been hearing from some of you. Anthony Ralston, new contract today, some thoughts on the win at Livy. It is a big night of football. We're going to go to Rugby Park very soon. We'll bring you team news. We'll build up to that game. There's a big one in the Women's Nations League at Hampden as well. Of course, Scotland coming close. A good performance against England on Friday, but no result there. And it is League Cup quarter-final week across the board as well. So loads to get through. I'm still after you Inverness fans or big Duncan Ferguson observers who want to share your thoughts. Let's do this first.
Beat the Pundit with the Scottish Sun.
For the best football news and opinion online, thescottishsun.co.uk/football.
And as if that's not enough, going to give away a prize in the not-too-distant future that's right up your street.
Right. Do you need to win the prize or just give it away?
I need to win it, but okay. You can't win it. But
some sort of golf prize.
Oh, see, you know him well, don't you? There's only two things, Jim, that Gordon deals into. Golf, and the other thing he's into, we can't give prizes away for on this show.
That,
so
that
let's play Beat the Pundit before we get ourselves in trouble. Martin's in Bears Den. How's it going, Martin?
Nah, not bad, thanks.
Have you ever played before?
Not live, no.
Perfect. Not live. Yeah, I suppose he's got me.
Playing the podcast.
Right, Martin, it is fairly straightforward. I do like to ridicule him because he has his moments, but you're not in terrible form.
No, I'm good for him. I'm in good for him.
5-0 to the Pundits last week. That cannot do. Heads, it will be Gordon Diel. Tails, it will be Jim Duffy. Right, let's test your form then. It's heads, Gordon, against Martin.
Here we go.
Martin's bottled it already.
Let's give Gordon some greatest hits radio, if you can. Turn it up nice and loud. And we'll give Martin the questions. Martin, you've got 30 seconds. Answer them however quickly you like. I would recommend you do speed up and pass if you don't know the answer, okay?
Yeah, no worries.
Good man. Jim Duffy, go put those headphones on because I can now just hear that music blaring through your mic. Right, 30 seconds on the clock, Martin, and your time starts now. Cyril Dessers plays for which international side?
Nigeria.
Arthur Boric's nephew Max plays for which Scottish team?
Hammond.
Which current Scottish Championship side did Duncan Ferguson play for before Rangers?
Pass.
Name any player who's played in the Scottish top flight this season aged 16.
Pass.
How many Scottish teams has Scott Wright played for?
Two.
Former Celtic winger Marian Shved now plays for which Ukrainian side?
Shakhtar.
Which Scottish League One team are the only SPFL side to have won their last five games?
Falkirk.
Right, let's bring him back. Can you hear us? What was that song that Jim Duffy liked so much?
The Way You Make Me Feel, Michael Jackson.
Yeah.
Just as well the camera was on you and the odds two dancing.
That was good.
I thought, honestly,
that would have been horrific.
Absolutely. Come on, let's get this over with.
Time starts now. Right. Cyril Dessers plays for which international side?
France, don't know.
Arthur Boric's nephew Max plays for which Scottish team?
Kilmarnock.
Which current Scottish Championship team did Duncan Ferguson play for before Rangers?
Dundee United.
Name any player who's played in the Scottish top flight this season aged 16.
Miller.
How many Scottish teams has Scott Wright played for?
Three.
Former Celtic winger Marian Shved now plays for which Ukrainian team? Which Scottish League One side are the only SPFL team who've won their last five games?
Falkirk.
What's the verdict, Martin?
I think it's quite tight, but we'll find out in a minute.
We will find out in a minute. Right, a couple of things.
I got off to a bad start. I know.
Cyril Dessers.
I know.
Listen, I don't mean to be too harsh on the guy. Does he strike you as being a France international, having seen his early season performances?
I mean, Mbappe could be linking up well there.
Keeping Giroud out the team.
Nah.
No.
I thought maybe it'd be like Walsh, have half a cap.
It is, of course, topical, Martin, isn't it? Do you listen to the show regularly?
I'm not good with countries, Dan.
I'm also nice.
Did you
Would
hear,
you go for Martin?
No. Did you hear Cyril Dessers being spoken about last night?
Aye.
Oh, he got that then.
I played the clip to you in the office.
Oh, sure you did.
He was referred to as the Nigerian. There you go.
1-0
to Martin. Arthur Boric's nephew, Max. Hibs. Yeah. He came on and injury issues.
So still 1-0?
Still 1-0. I'm disappointed in you, Martin. Martin, are you a young man?
30.
That's young.
It's young. You didn't get the answer.
Well, to be fair, it is because Duncan Ferguson left Dundee United on the year Martin was born, presumably.
It must be over because I played against Duncan Ferguson when he was at Dundee United. So there you go.
I would like to be in the middle of 50-50 between the
keep
two.
Keep this going, my
there was a 50-50 between you and Big Dunks said Duff 50-50. He actually said that to me, the ball was in the air. And if you'll notice, if you had came close and the camera came close, I've got a scar just above my where I...
Seriously, you've got a Duncan Ferguson scar?
I've got an elbow. Bang, take that.
And he was so how young was he at that point?
He was he was probably about 19 or 20, and I would be, I don't know, maybe my 30s. But anyway.
You'd be staying out of the way of they two, wouldn't you, Gordon?
And then, obviously, it took me about a good 20 minutes to get retribution.
And did you manage it?
Of course.
No doubt.
Oh, yeah.
Right, anyway. So it's 1-1. Name any player who's played in the top flight, age 16. You had a couple of choices. It was a big weekend for it. Fran Franjak, Rory Whittaker of Hibs, Bailey Rice of Rangers. Mm. Lennon Miller is now 17.
Yeah, but he played at 16.
2-1 Gordon DL. Scott Wright's played for Rangers, Aberdeen,
Ross County,
and Dundee on loan. It's 3.
Oh, Dundee. Oh, he's
2 ahead of you, Martin. However, you didn't know that Marian Shved's played for Shakhtar Donetsk, and Martin did.
Doesn't matter. So 2 plus, I've got Falkirk in the bag.
He pulls it to within 1.
There are 4.
Martin did get Falkirk as well.
There are 4. 4-3.
That's not enough.
Oh, unlucky Martin. There's no ball going to Bears then, Martin.
Martin, I think you can hold your head high. I
do you see
fine.
That big thing in front there? That's what you could have won.
Martin might not be watching on the live stream.
Oh, you watching, Martin?
He's just listening.
Listening.
He's on the phone to us at the moment.
Yeah, but he can still be on the mobile.
Anyway, Martin, that was good. It was good. You just met a better man.
Victory, man.
Hello. Man in form.
Hard lines, Martin. Take care.
Defeated. I am flying, by
I'm
the way.
I'm just trying to play. I'm trying to speak to the callers and you're
I don't care.
On
it's all about me tonight.
It's entertainment. You're entertaining.
There, beat the pundit. Gordon 4, Martin 3. Boom.
Dear me. Right, 4-3, okay. Fella. Let's go to Rugby Park and get teams with Gabriel.
Thanks, Gordon. Yes, it's Kilmarnock against Hearts in the first of this season's League Cup quarter-finals. A strong start to the season quickly evaporated for Killy, although they still sit eighth in the table. And I hear in this competition, they are not in form. They've only won one of their last 6. Incidentally, that game was the pivotal one. It was here last month against Celtic in the previous round of this tournament, knocking out the holders. They have been so impressive in Cup since Derek McInnes arrived. He hopes to extend that record here this evening by securing another trip to the National Stadium. He said he believes that him and his players can lift this trophy. Interestingly, Gordon, Killy have had the upper hand in this fixture recently. In the last 9 meetings, they've won 6 times and only lost once. Let's have a look at the team news then. Just one change for the hosts. Youngster David Watson comes in for the injured Marley Watkins. Looks like it'll be a 4-5-1 formation. Will Dennison goal. A back 4 of Lewis Mayo, Stuart Finlay, Joe Wright and Robbie Dees. Dan Armstrong will be on one wing with Matty Kennedy on the other. Brad Lyons, David Watson and Kyle McGinnis in midfield. Kyle Vassell, the captain, leads the line. Hearts themselves also in a poor run of form. Stephen Naismith already under some serious pressure despite only being officially appointed a few weeks ago. They've lost 5 of their last 6 games. Victory here, of course, will secure that trip to Hampden in November and relieve a lot of the strain on Naismith at the helm if he can get it done tonight. They make 3 changes. Civic, Forrest and Grant are in for Atkinson, Beringame and Boyce. So it looks like this, they're starting 11. Xander Clark in goal, a defence of Frankie Kent, Toby Civic, Kai Rolls and Stephen Kingsley. Callum Nevenhoff, Cammy Devlin and George Grant in midfield. Alan Forrest and Kenneth Vargas on the wings with captain Lawrence Shanklin leading the line. The referee here will be Stephen McLean. Greg Aitken is on the VAR. It's dreadful weather down in Ayrshire, Gordon. We're expecting thunder and lightning as well. We can hear it and we can expect it to get worse by kickoff. Don't forget as well, it will be decided tonight by extra time and penalties if needed.
I don't know if Gabriel's Stephen Naismith's agent trying to imply that he was only officially appointed a few weeks ago, so cut him some slack. Mm. Come on.
Well, he was kind of appointed in then because he didn't have a...
So does this mean Stephen Naismith's now in his second spell as Hearts manager then?
Yeah.
Is that the way we're looking
well,
at
that's
it?
That's exactly what it is then.
Simon's a Kilmarnock fan. Simon, you've heard the teams. Your team going to come out on top?
Hi, guys. I certainly hope so. I'm pleased with David Watson being back in the midfield. Him and Lennon Miller will be the Scotland midfield for the next 15-20 years. Mm. So good to see that. Good to see him back, but Marley Watkins is definitely going to be a loss today. He's been excellent.
Yeah, talk us through how you arrive in this one then. You can become unofficial League Cup favourites in a weird way by knocking out Celtic, and obviously had beaten Rangers at the start of the season as well. What's changed since then, or has anything changed?
No, I think we've played relatively well. I heard the guy on Saturday complaining, but I think that was maybe just heat in the moment stuff. I was up at the game on against Dundee, and it's one of those games where we literally could have won it on another day by 5 or 6. You need to take those chances. The cell missed to the absolute sniffers. You know, there was a couple of sort of Matty Kennedy heading off the post. That was even before, you know, the second half, which was just an onslaught. I think the Ross County game, the less said about that refereeing decision, the better. The Hibs game was a decent comeback. I think we're still in decent form. We're set up better under McInnes to take on quote-unquote better teams, which is quite, you know, you then think, will that actually play into our favour today? Because our heart's any better. Certainly not in the form they're in at the moment. So, yeah, it's going to be a really interesting game.
Do you feel like there is a fragility around Hearts and the level of criticism they're getting at the moment, Simon, that you can take advantage of?
Yeah, possibly, but they're still a really good team. You look at any team that's got Lawrence Shankland playing up front, you know, they're always going to have a threat. So I don't know if fragility is the right word, but coming to Rugby Park, you know, we've got an excellent record against Hearts, as your reporter said. So, you know, we've got to try and take advantage of it. If we get an early goal, then, you know, it certainly could, you know, up the ante a bit.
Yeah, I mean, the reason I mention it, you've seen sort of like Ann Budge out graffiti outside Tynecastle or whatever, or there's a banner somewhere and there's graffiti somewhere. Hearts fans are pretty annoyed at the recent form. Gordon, how do you feel this one goes tonight?
Yeah, I think Simon and Gabs down at Rugby Park will win for a long night. I think it'll go.
It's gone the distance.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
And yeah. The thunder and lightning as well.
Simon Perrins.
I really do. I think first goal wins it for me. I know what Simon's saying. He goes every week and he watches them. He's got a better idea of them. Hearts are in terrible form just now. I think they're all over the place. They should be doing better. You look at the squad that they've got, probably the third biggest in Scottish football, budget-wise, up there with Aberdeen. And what they got, 7 points out of 6. They've been dreadful. Kilmarnock got off to such a terrific start, and everybody was talking so highly about them. But taking a little dip, I think they'd be disappointed at Dens Park and Dundee going down to 10 men and obviously Dundee getting the equaliser. It's a big, big game for them tonight. Advantage, maybe because they're at home on the surface. I really couldn't call that because I don't see any of the two teams that are going to dominate that game tonight for me. But as I say, first goal wins it.
I mean, look, Simon's right. Hearts do have good players, but maybe that's why the Hearts fans are feeling so critical about the way things are at the moment.
Yeah, I mean, they are. I mean, the expectations are always high. That was the reason why, you know, Stephen Naismith got appointed. You know, they felt that Robbie Nielsen had taken the club as far as they could and they wanted to make a change. So, you know, they have to finish at least at third. You know, that is the minimum requirement now for Hearts, a Hearts manager, as well as hoping to do well in the cup competitions. So yeah, there is a high expectation level, but I'm not quite sure about the Ann Budge scenario. Is Hearts not a fan based club now, or a fan owned club now? So I just think that like a lot of teams just now. I mean, you look at Aberdeen, we're taking a wee bit of stick.
She's
up
still
until
the
last
CEO
week.
Though, isn't she? I think that's
yeah.
That's
and Aberdeen won 4-0 convincingly at the weekend, and all of a sudden everything in the garden's a bit rosy. Hearts go down to command tonight. If they come through that and in the semi final. You know, then they're, you know, they could transform their season really. But I'm with Gordon. I think at home the conditions could play a part tonight, as Gabriel was saying there. You know, could be horrendous down there. In which cases you've got to deal with that. And you know, command that, I think from set plays. You know, in terms of the balance of the team, there's a little bit more consistency there. I would just edge Kilmarnock at home tonight.
Derek McInnes is good at getting to the latter stages of cup competitions, Simon. Obviously taking the next step and winning them is a different matter, but is that sort of aim for this season? You got that realistically in your sights?
Simon's off.
No, he's there somewhere. Got you now, Simon. Sorry, on you go.
I was just saying Viaplay just before I came on. We're showing the highlights of the win over Celtic. I think looking at Rangers, as you've heard with their reaction of the fans, they are absolutely rotten this season, as I was arguing with Hugh Keevans at the start of the season about. I think whoever wins, see if you look at the list of, say, St Mirren, Aberdeen and Kelly go through, or St Mirren, Aberdeen and Hearts go through, I think all those teams beat Rangers in a semi-final or a final, because Michael Beale can't win big games. So it's just I think it's going to be a new name in the League Cup this season. Why can't it be us? You know, we've already beat the holders, beat the favourites, beat probably the best team in Scotland. So going up against the rest of them, you know, tonight's going to be the big test. If we can get through tonight, that should hopefully give the team a bit of confidence. We've been missing Corey and Dabba. He's back on the bench. He gives us a bit more shape and solidity. It's just a big, big game. And as you say, Derek knows how to get to the semi-finals and finals. This would be our second visit there since 2012. You know, the one being last year. We were mightily unlucky against Celtic. So, you know, it's a huge night. But, you know, I think the winner comes from the other teams. I don't see Rangers winning it. I don't think they've got the metal or the bottle to win it. I think they're a team in crisis, and I think one of the other teams wins it.
I tell you what, predicting the winner of the cup quarter final stage, it's early even by your standards. Takes time. Look, Rangers obviously aren't in a good place. You do sometimes feel like, whether it would be Kilmarnock, St Mirren, whoever it may be, you'd probably want to try and get them before it goes to Hampden, though. And again, I know Michael Beale doesn't have a brilliant record in these so-called big games that Simon mentions, but you know, if Simon could get Rangers down at Rugby Park, or St Mirren could get them in Paisley, but obviously it's the quarter-finals. Hampden is just around the corner.
I think where the argument will fall down a little bit for Simon, and listen, all for him coming on and supporting his team. He goes and spends his money and follows him up and down the country. If it's Kilmarnock, for instance, tonight, and it's St Mirren and Aberdeen, those three teams will be hoping they don't draw Rangers at Hampden. Mm-hmm. Let's be honest about it. Because for me, and I know that Rangers aren't great form, I've already said that I've not enjoyed their football. But for me, I would much rather, if I was Kilmarnock and say, for instance, Aberdeen, St Mirren, Rangers in a draw, I would be looking to avoid Rangers still at this moment in time. And then if Rangers happen to progress to final, take your chances there. But in a semi-final, when that draw is there, all the teams are wanting to avoid Rangers.
Enjoy your night, Simon. Gordon thinks it's going to be a late one. We will see how that one pans out. Looking forward to it, though. I must say, Kilmarnock against Hearts in the first of the League Cup quarter-finals. Right, I've been looking forward to this because we had a good bit of fun last night. Doesn't take long, and a good prize given away as well. Let's play.
Clyde One Super Scoreboard with James Frew. Need a gas engineer, plumber, joiner or electrician? Contact them today.
Right, so all this week we've teamed up with James Frew, Scotland's leading property solutions company. They've got offices across Glasgow and the West. You can check out the details of their academy programme at jamesfrew.co.uk. And it's another great prize, and it is a golfing prize tonight, Gordon. A four ball at West Kilbride. You'd like that?
I played it. It's nice. Sure, nice course. If there's only three, give me a call in 0141 951 1025.
All you have to do is tell us who is the scorer of this famous goal in Scottish football history we're about to play. James Frew started in 1911, so we've sort of rolled back the commentary, given it a bit of an antique feel. So who scores this famous Scottish goal? Listen.
Off by the big number nine, and here comes the long-haired Scandinavian driving past the backs. And he's chipped it past the goalkeeper. The Glasgow Rangers goalkeeper doesn't know where to look. And he makes it 4-1. An excellent example of association football.
Oh, you'll get that. You will get that. If you
know who's...
that
does. I would like to think so.
Right, don't give it away. If you know, do you genuinely not know who that was?
No.
Oh, you're hopeless. If you know who scored that goal, give us a call, 0141 951 1025. You need to be over 18, and you have until the end of this break to call. Get in touch now, and you could be a winner with James Frew. Clyde One Super Scoreboard. Jim Duffy and Gordon DL are here. Keep those calls coming in, 0141 951 1025. Still loads of time to talk to us before we go, just before 8 o'clock. And before we go any further, I always like giving prizes away. Let's do it.
Clyde One Super Scoreboard with James Frew. Need a gas engineer, plumber, joiner or electrician? Contact them today.
Yes, this week on Clyde One Super Scoreboard, we're teaming up with James Frew, Scotland's leading property solutions company, and giving away a nice prize every night. We did it last night. We're going to do it again tonight. You can head over to jamesfrew.co.uk for your building and property services. We're asking you to tell us who scored this famous Scotland goal. Let's bring in tonight's contestant first of all. Mark is in Jordan Hill. How's it going, Mark?
Hello, Gordon. How are you doing? Thanks. Doing good.
Let's hear it, because your task is who scored this famous goal. We've changed the commentary a bit. Let's hear it.
It's laid off by the big number nine, and here comes the long-haired Scandinavian driving past the backs. And he's chipped it past the goalkeeper. The Glasgow Rangers goalkeeper doesn't know where to look. And he makes it 4-1. An excellent example of association football.
Retro commentary. Genuinely, this won't surprise you, Mark. genuinely, during the break, Gordon Dale explained to us that he doesn't know who that is because it sounds like it was a really long time ago. Which just like, it's literally the point of the competition. I explained it that.
I thought Archie McPherson had a cold.
He said he thought it might be Mario Kempes.
He didn't.
He's an Argentinian and not Scandinavian. He was 1978,
Put him out his misery. Mark, who was it?
Is it Henrik Larsson?
It is indeed. Well done. You've won the four ball at West Kilbride Golf Course, all thanks to James Frew. Please say you've got three pals, because you'll need to take him with you if you don't.
Come on, Mark.
I certainly do. Yeah, I've got the father-in-law and my partner's two cousins. They're big golfers.
Cousins?
You're out. Unlucky. Well done. Thanks very much to Mark for winning tonight's prize. More coming in the rest of the week as well. Do you get the format now? Yeah, be all right. If we play it tomorrow, you won't be surprised.
I won't be surprised, but I'll be better equipped on Thursday when I'm in.
Just think it might be like the young whippersnapper from Motherwell. Dives low, the ball hits his nose and goes in, and he'll be dancing in the streets of Wraith tonight. You know, that sort of thing.
Yeah, I didn't listen to the question, unfortunately.
My word.
I thought Archie's obviously changed his twang in years gone by.
You'll be desperate to get involved in this golf prize. I don't even know if the rest
is
of the
all golf.
Well, I don't know, but it was last night and tonight, so I'm starting to notice a bit.
Well,
of a
I hope Thursday's a better golf course.
It's more tomorrow.
Thursday night, because I'm on Thursday with Wilson, isn't it? Better golf course.
Is he back?
He's back. He'll be back. From big red faces. Turn the colour down in your screens on Thursday night.
Oh, he'll be red. There's no doubt about that.
Lobster Wilson will be back in the building.
Anyway, right.
Teaser, mate.
There's been a new managerial appointment in Scotland today, and it's an interesting one. So we're going to look at that in just a second. Let's get the question up and running for your teaser, though.
The full-time teaser with Sliding Wardrobe Solutions East Kilbride. Score winning wardrobes at their new trade counter at Colville's Road.
Stevie from Falkirk wants you to name eight Rangers players who've scored a brace against Celtic since 2000. Eight Rangers players who've scored a brace against Celtic since 2000. Any that spring to mind?
Since 2000, I'll go...
Tavernier.
Yeah. Yes, the most recent one. That was the 3-2 game April this year.
Lovenkrantz.
Yeah, the Scottish Cup final, no less. May 2002. Same scoreline, 3-2.
Kenny Miller.
Twice he's done it. Well done, we'll leave it there. That's three and only five to get. You can see the question on the screen if you're watching on the live stream, and it will be on Twitter as well. X, I'm going to try and correct myself, but I can't promise that will catch on. Kenny actually went to Ibrox at the weekend. Someone stopped him and said, could you sign this, Kenny? And it was a picture he sent me. It's great, we'll need to get it in for when Mark returns. And it's a picture of Kenny sort of wheeling away in celebration, but you can he's obviously scored on Wilson. And he's standing distraught.
Is that the back post one?
I think
I'm sure it might be.
Anyway, let's reflect on some of the other big talking points from today, because I love this. And I mean no disrespect to the great people up at Inverness, but there's something extra intriguing about this managerial appointment that's got us talking tonight. I think because of the name, Duncan Ferguson has been announced as the next Inverness Cali Thistle manager, replaces Billy Dodds, who was sacked just over a week ago. Let's bring in Stevie, who's on. He's an Inverness fan. You can hear Stevie on the Winest Shuffle podcast. Stevie, what do you make of that appointment? Did you see it coming?
Hi, Gordon. No, out of the blue, it's box office, isn't it? I mean, we've been doing it on our podcast this week about who would come in. It's like a game of guess who. It's been Darren O'Day, it was Scott Brown, it was Robbie Nielsen, it was Dougie Emery, but we never had Big Duncan on our radar. So it's a box office appointment for this level, so we'll see how he gets on.
From a purely surprising point of view, I think Stevie's right, because usually nothing stays secret anymore. No. The names are out there. I think, did someone not just say they saw Scott Brown in Inverness? I think that was it. Stevie, I don't know, you can tell me if I'm wrong.
He's playing golf, I think, Gordon, but yeah, that's the only reason he's up in Inverness. So
there we are. And there was nothing in it. You know, there was an email. I think media knew there was a managerial appointment this morning. And then by late last night, by the time we had gone, you started hearing the name. So it's box office, right? We'll start there.
Mm-hmm. 100%.
Yeah, agree with that?
Oh, yeah, it's a big name, isn't it?
Yeah, big by stature as well, as Jim Duffy's cheekbone found out. He doesn't have a load of managerial success under his belt, Stevie? I mean, I obviously wouldn't say that to his face.
Well, he's none.
Yeah, that's why I tried to. It was a euphemism. Listen, just because you're big and ugly enough to take him on, yeah. I'll be nice for now. Stevie, does that concern you at all?
Well, he won one in 18 at Forest Green, so he's got experience. But yeah, that's what worries me. And I'm warming a little bit too, because I've heard the assistant probably going to be Gary Boland, who's got a good knowledge of sort of Scottish football. But he needs help. I don't think he's been in Scotland for 30 years. Probably Gordon. I think he was. Well, Gordon Dale probably played in that game against Race Rovers. They obviously had the headbutt in John McStay.
You'd
have been playing Gordon, but I think.
Yeah, I see him picking somebody bigger. There's my centre half.
What do you think? From the outset, though, like Inverness, again, with no offence, you're not getting a manager that ticks every box. I mean, quite clearly. So, have they leaned more towards the sort of, you know, the name and the stature and the certainly the presence and that sort of thing? You know, not overlooked, but. You're then sacrificing the sort of the managerial CV, if you like.
No, there's no set formula for who's going to be a successful manager. You know, you can be the highest profile, or you can be a guy that's basically hardly kicked a ball. But the one thing is you know that Steve that's saying there is sorry George saying that your club is certainly going to get more you know column inches. It's going to get more in the spotlight. The TV is going to be interested. There's no doubt about it. It's putting the name Inverness back on the map and probably getting as much publicity, not as much, but since the last time when they won the cup or when they beat Celtic in that famous night, so it's got them back in the back pages. With a guy like Duncan, and listen, he wants to go up there. He wants to prove himself. He had a short time at Forest Green, didn't quite work out. It'll be interesting to see how he does there. I mean, it is a risky appointment in the sense of a football side, because as I said, he's not been in Scotland. He won't have the same resources, the same budgets, all these type of things, but he has got a fantastic presence. There's no doubt about it. Every player will know Duncan when he walks in, and we've heard this many, many times that when a manager walks in, straight away the players react to that. I think they'll get an immediate reaction. Can he sustain that reaction? We'll have to wait and see. But I definitely think there'll be an immediate reaction from the players. I think they will absolutely buy into that. And I think the fans, it'll be great. It's great for the club. But you've got to be successful on the pitch. And that's going to take a bit of time.
He's got the job and his personality. Let's be honest about it. He's probably, if you're Inverness bored, you've looked at the managers he's worked under. And that must impress you.
That's what I was going to say. We've been a bit unfair then, because look, you get one stint at management. Mm-hmm. It could be that the club's a basket case. You know, think things go against you. He's obviously coached at an extremely high level for a while.
And the thing you've got to say about him is a little bit like John Kennedy at Celtic for me. Mm-hmm. Every manager come in, always kept him. Now, you're not telling me, I know that he's a big boy and you'd probably get a chairman to tell him to leave, but you're not telling me if you get in there and you've got everything at your disposal, you've not got the power to turn around and say, I want to bring my own backroom staff here. Dunk's been here a long time. I want him out. So they've kept him. The reason they've kept him, they must have seen something in him, Gordon. And you're right. You can't just judge everybody with the one appointment. You don't know what was happening at Forest Green. It could have been the wrong fit. His record doesn't look good. Let's be honest about it. Doesn't look good. I agree with Jim. If you're a player at Inverness just now and you're needing a lift, you're going to get that initial lift, right? You certainly are at training. You're looking forward to him coming in. You want to see what he's got to bring to the table. But the most important thing, especially now, bottom of the league, he needs to start winning games. That's what he's there for.
I mean, Stevie, it's a 3-year contract. I've got this image of the talks and saying, here you are, Duncan, there's a 2-year contract. And he says, I think you'll find it's 3. And they go, no bother, big man. Let's call it 3. Take 5 if you want. But it's quite a show of faith, Stevie, isn't it? That length of contract.
Yeah, it's also worrying. I don't think you get many managers out with maybe the old firm giving 3-year contracts out. And we've obviously had to obviously give Billy some severance after saying the 2-year contract a few months ago. So I'm a bit worried about the length of contract. I think that could be worrying long term. But it does show, obviously, intent from the board. And yeah, I think that's a lot of fans in Inverness think that that's the draw of Duncan's good, but the 3-year contract is a bit worrying if it doesn't go.
Yeah.
But he's not going to take the job unless he gets a decent contract. Let's be honest, he's not going to go up to Inverness for a year or you know, anything like that. So he needed an incentive. They're not going to pay him the money.
The difference, though, I feel like two you would expect, whereas three sounds long.
Gordon, if somebody wants you, you're not going to get anywhere near the money that he would get even in a lower level than England. So they have to give him a longer contract, give him the chance to try and put his stamp on the team. But Stevie said, you know, listen, the fans are certainly going to be excited by it. The players will be excited by it. He's got to get somebody in with, you know, whether it's Gary Bowen or, you know, was talking about, you know, Ray McKinnon or these kind of guys. You know, he has to get people in who know the game and know who's going to be playing against, you know, the style of football, all that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. And then he can do his bit in his man management skills because, as Gordon said, he does have a terrific reputation in amongst the players at Everton. And guys like Carlo Ancelotti don't keep guys just on reputation. Absolutely not. He keeps guys on quality and you know, and knowledge. And Duncan Ferguson was kept on by people like him. So, you know, he's definitely got a football knowledge. Can he go and rise to that challenge that is a big challenge now and being bottom of the league? Mm-hmm.
Thanks very much to Stevie. You can hear Stevie's thoughts on the Wine is Shuffle podcast as well. Let's hear from the man himself telling us how he's feeling about returning to Scottish football.
I believe that they've got a good team. At the moment we're underperforming. I think we can find improvements. And the club have got a really big ambition to go back to the Premier League where they've been before. Unfortunately, that's not the case at the moment. But they've certainly got a lot of good ideas how to get there. So that's one of the reasons. That's the main reason why I came. The ambition of the club, ambition of myself, and it's a great opportunity for myself. Football's football, isn't it? So it doesn't matter where it is. You know, it can be in England, it can be in Scotland. No, but obviously it's nice to come back up to Scotland, where you know it's my home. But that was no the reason why I took the job. You know what I mean? The reason I took the job because I think this club is, can move in the right direction. But it is great to be back. I do obviously come and visit. You know, so I'm not totally been doing south forever. I have got family up here, so yeah. But it's lovely to be back.
I like that notion you said. So when that high ball went up to the two, he called it. He said, 50-50, Duff. Yeah. Let's go.
Yeah, the ball was getting kicked for the goalkeeper. And he said before it, 50-50, Duff, and he just
whacked
me. And I was going for the ball, and he thought, I'll just give you. And I don't even think he get given away. I felt at that time. But the thing is about Duncan, it was good to see that he's picked up that lovely English accent and all that. I've been doing there for 30 years. So it was great. He just sounded as if he's, you know, he's got that enthusiasm, he's got that excitement about being a manager again. So listen, if he brings that to the table and he's successful, you know, everybody in Inverness, you know, buy into that. That you know, they do have ambition, but there's a lot of clubs now, Gordon, with ambitions and investment, and that's the most important thing. He needs the financial backing, and I don't know if Inverness can supply that.
We will find out. Sure to be an interesting watch, no matter which way it goes. Let's see how you're doing on Stevie from Falkirk's teaser. 8 Rangers players have scored a brace against Celtic since 2000. Lovenkrantz, Miller and Tavernier.
Neil McCann.
No.
Novo.
Yes. One more guess.
Ilovich.
Nope.
Yeah. Naismith.
Yes, and we'll get the rest of the answers next. Clyde 1 Super Scoreboard. Getting there at Rugby Park, Kilmarnock against Hearts in the first of the League Cup quarter-finals. So we'll keep an eye on things there, and about to get underway at Hampden as well for the Scotland Women's National Team. Their second Nations League match Friday night, went to Sunderland, played ever so well, denied a ridiculous penalty, and lost 2-1 to England. So hopefully can get some points on the board tonight. Lee Gibson in goal, 50th cap there. Nicola Docherty, Rachel Corsi, Sophie Howard, Sam Kerr, Caroline Weir, Kirsty Hansen, the scorer from Friday, Rachel McLaughlin, Claire Emsley, Martha Thomas, and Christy Grimshaw as well. Rangers, Kirsty Howitts on the bench, first ever call up for her there as well. So hopefully that goes to plan for Pedro Martinez Losa's side. We've already given you team news from the other game, which was Gabriel live there at Rugby Park, so we'll see how we go there. What about your teaser tonight? Stevie from Falkirk sent it in. Can you name 8 Rangers players who've scored a brace against Celtic since 2000? You've got Peter Lovenkrantz, Nacho Novo, Kenny Miller twice, Stephen Naismith and James Tavernier.
Gordon's on fire with this one. On you go, Gordon.
Connor Golson.
Yes, an unlikely brace scorer. Okay. Two to get.
Kemir Roof.
Yes, well done. 4-1 on the day, May 2021. So you've only got one to get, so we'll get it before the end of the show. We're getting an actual prediction for tonight, just that it's going to go the distance.
Yeah, 5-10 finish. Probably penalty kicks.
Right, who's winning the penalties then?
It's a lottery. It's a lottery, as they say.
I totally agree. I think Kelly with home advantage will win the penalty kick shootout.
Right, but not enough that they'll just win it in normal time.
I'll go Kelly 2-1.
After 2-1. Extra time?
I mean, possibly, but I'll go for 2-1, Kelly.
I'm thinking.
I mean, in isolation, there's no shame in that. You can go to Rugby Park and be edged out. If you're right, there will be quite a reaction from the Hearts fans, I think. You know, you look at it, I'd said it before, and I know it's just one or two examples, but I do always feel like once you're at graffiti outside the stadium and banners hanging from railway bridge stage, defeats don't tend to go down too well.
No, I don't think they can afford to come back up the road with a defeat. They need to be in the draw for the next round of this.
I think with Celtic being out the cup as well, it's made it more open. You know, we had one of the guys earlier saying about the feel that Rangers, you know, might not have the mental toughness to win that, but that's still to be seen. They've still got to beat Livingston tomorrow night to get to the semi-final. It is only the quarters, but it is a more open tournament, there's no doubt about that. And both Kilmarnock and Hearts will have aspirations of not just winning the tie tonight, but actually winning the trophy.
Yeah, it's going to be an interesting one. Both will fancy it, and I guess that is the case across this week as well, Jim. Some great fixtures still to come. It's just unusual for recent seasons to not have Celtic involved. It does open it up a bit, as you say. There's lots to look forward to in the next couple of nights.
Yeah, I mean, I think particularly, you know, that Ross County against Aberdeen, you know, just absolutely battered Ross County 4-0 at the weekend, and you know, the scoreline, you know, didn't flatter Aberdeen at all. You know, very comprehensive. And that, so Ross County at home this time, trying to come up with some sort of game plan that they can stifle Aberdeen. Hibs and St Mirren tomorrow night. I mean, listen, Hibs with the new manager coming in, good victory against St John's at the weekend. St Mirren on terrific form, really been good. Not just this season, but since Stevie Robertson went into St Mirren, really, you know, they've got a real method of playing, understanding, you know, they're difficult to beat. So that, again, as Gordon says, that one could go right to the last seconds. And obviously Rangers against Livingston, again, the pressure, no doubt. But Livingston, a different type of pressure, with David Martindale today saying that, you know, new owners coming in, taking over, and they might want their own guy in. Now, what a job he has done at Livingston. For me, if they change the management there, it'd be scandalous, I have to say that. He's done an outstanding job with the resources that Livingston have, the fan base they have, how he's kept them in the Premier League comfortably every single year, and developed some of the players. Recruitment's been terrific. I just think he's done a remarkable job there, and doesn't deserve to be looking over his shoulder. Deserves a healthy long-term contract.
I take the graffiti and the bedsheet on the railway bridge and raise you a banner at Rugby Park tonight in the away end that says, "Funded by fans, ran by clowns. We deserve better."
They're not happy, the Hearts fans. And to be fair to them, especially at Tynecastle, they turn out in great numbers, Gordon. They turn out in great numbers away from home as well.
But what did they want, Gordon? I mean, in terms of the background, they wanted Robbie Nielsen out, who I thought done a terrific job there.
Yeah.
And Robbie, sadly, lost his job. So they've appointed Stephen Naismith and obviously Frankie McAvoy as a kind of combination of coaches and management there. So what is it, just, you know, the hierarchy, they don't think there's enough investment, or the recruitment's been poor?
I think the appointment of a management team that isn't working at the moment would probably be the main reason.
So yeah, that's what I'm saying. They think that it's the management team, it's not the board, it's not Anne Budge and, you know, her board.
No, but then by extension, the people who appoint them. You're not going to...
Joe Savage, for instance.
You can still think that, and I'm sort of guessing here, you can still think, you know, that Stephen Naismith doing, you know, a less than satisfactory job for you, but at the same time, you know, he is young, he is inexperienced, he doesn't have the qualifications that meant this full UEFA thing had to take place. So do you actually aim all your anger at him, or do you look at the decision to appoint that manager?
I think you've got to look at the decisions that come from above. because they make the decision to point them. Stephen Naismith can't just turn around and say,
he's not going to say no.
Yeah, to the exactly. And he's got to be given the opportunity. So that's where I think the anger's aimed at. I think it's above. It's not Stephen Naismith, because Jim will tell you, every manager, every coach, given that opportunity to manage a club the size of ours, would certainly grasp it with both hands. So it's coming, it's been pointed to above.
Lively enough start in both games. Lauren Shankland had a sort of curling effort from distance that did go wide at Hampden. Martha Thomas tried to break down the left. Caroline Weir had a corner. Rachel McLaughlin couldn't get the shot beyond the goalkeeper either there. So still waiting on the first goal in those ones. If we get one before the end of the show, I will let you know, although we are of course fast running out of time. But it should be a good week, Gordon, in the League Cup quarter-final stage.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to some good games tomorrow. I think the pick of the bunch has got to be Easter Road for me. I know in the opening game St Mirren went there, got a good 3-2 victory. We're cruising at one point. Hibs showed a bit of character, back to two each. Hibs went, St Mirren up the park.
There's
got
a story
win
here, Jim, right? He bothered his backside to go to a game of football.
Do you know why? You know, right?
And he's not stopped banging on about it.
17,500 was there. And I think it'll be the same tomorrow night.
It is a talent, though. I mean, to be fair, this one is relevant, but you managed to bring every talking point back to the fact that you went to a game, you went to Hibs,
right,
against
St Mirren. Right, okay. Right, can I ask you a question then? If you're honest, you look at these three fixtures tomorrow night, what one would you pick to watch? What one do you think is going to be the most exciting?
Yeah, I wouldn't argue with that.
Okay then, so my point's valid. 17,500, Jim. There'll be that there tomorrow night.
Plus you.
But, look, the caller was on earlier talking about, oh, Livingston. I don't see Livingston upsetting Rangers at all. I think Rangers will win the hat.
That's interesting. You wonder, is it like an absolute, is it 4D chess from Malky Mackay? Just play terrible, let Aberdeen battery, lull them into a full sense of security, dump them out the cup. No.
Yeah, well, possibly. I mean, again, don't get me wrong, Ross County have started the season well up until the weekend there. You know, they've been playing some good football. You know, they've been, you know, looking, you know, confident. But, you know, again, is it just a really, really poor performance? As you say, no matter how much Barry Robson will get these players and say, listen, this is an important match for us, this is an opportunity to get to semi-final, in the back of their heads, the players will be thinking, are we cuffed him easy at the weekend, 4-0? It's hard when all you know, when you get into a game when you've won as comfortable as you've had, to have that same intensity. And yeah, Ross County might just bring a surprise there. And I certainly think it'll be a lot closer, and I wouldn't put it past Malky to turn that game around.
Wouldn't be surprised in that. I really wouldn't.
Really?
Yeah, I really wouldn't. I don't think Aberdeen travel well. They struggled at Stirling. They had one of their worst performances at Tynecastle.
Did all right in Frankfurt, though.
Yeah, okay. Maybe that was a longer trip.
Lost, though.
But exactly, Jim. So I think Ross County will fancy that one at home. Will be difficult. It'll be tight as well.
Okay, right. I think we're nearly there. Let me just double check, make sure we've not got any early goals to tell you about in the two games that we referenced earlier on. No, still nothing there. Scotland doing most of the attacking in that Nations League game for the women against Belgium, and nothing yet at Rugby Park. So maybe they are in for a long night. Gordon Dale's prediction certainly believes that to be the case. On the teaser, we're looking for one more. We wanted you to name 8 Rangers players who've scored a brace against Celtic since 2000. Thanks again to the folks at Sliding Wardrobe Solutions, East Kilbride, for helping us out there. And Stevie from Falkirk sent the question in. Tavernier, Roof, Goldson, Stevie Naismith, Kenny Miller, Nacho Novo, Peter Lovenkrantz.
Struggling, Jim?
No. Chris Boyd, is that too?
No, Boyd didn't. Boyd. No chance.
No. Michael Moles.
Can you give us
do
a
you ever
little
play that game? Maybe, I don't know if professional footballers do it as a bit of fun in the training ground or when you were young, and if you lost, the forfeit was you would stand and they would blast the ball off your backside. Various names for it. Who's the last Rangers player you'd want
George
to do that?
George
Alberts. There we go. See, the clues come from various strange places.
Oh, his nickname is the Hammer, I think. So there's a bit of you certainly wouldn't want that to get hit.
No, you would not. And there we are. That does bring us up to the end of tonight's show. Thank you to Gordon DL and thank you to Jim Duffy. It was a pleasure as always. Thanks for all your calls and your tweets. It's so busy here. You always, you know, really amazes how often you get in touch. It really is never taken for granted. You can listen back wherever you get your podcast. You can watch back of course. Now make sure you like and subscribe to the YouTube page as well, YouTube channel I should say, and you get all sorts on there, so please do that for us if you can. And we are back tomorrow night, Marvin Bartley and Simon Donnelly, and in the meantime stay right there because Callum Gallagher is up next. Good night from us.